call. I'll start over again. Welcome to One Hour with Jane. I'm your host, and today I have April Berg on my show. She's actually a comedian from New York. What actually got you into doing stand-up comedy?
I have a very traumatic life starting at the age of 4. And I just started writing jokes about stuff that had happened to me. And my brother used to throw these huge parties for his employees. And I would just grab the microphone and had my notes. And I would just tell jokes. And everybody would laugh. And I wasn't sure if it was because they were drunk that they were laughing. Or if it was funny that they were laughing. And then I met my friend Eric, who is part of the Howard Stern Show. And he got me on stage down in New York City at Dangerfield. He actually introduced me to a manager who was my manager for a while. And I got on stage for the first time ever in front of 325 plus people. And I did my thing and I got lots of laughs. And actually my friends who were part of the Blue Bloods TV show, they came too. They were in the audience. So I had so many people there for me. It was great. It was a great experience. And it just made me feel so good that I decided this is what I want to do.
It takes a lot of guts to go on stage. I know people that are kind of shy and they wouldn't go on stage. Though they say a lot of comedians are shy, so do you think you did that to get out of your shyness?
Yes, I'm definitely shy. You put me in a group of 3-4 people, I will clam up. But you put me in front of hundreds of even millions on Howard, and I just go freely. I flow. Like, my stuff just flows.
Oh, that's good. Give me an example of what you say.
My stuff is very sexual. One of my first jokes that I really haven't said in a long time is regarding my PTSD. I am diagnosed with PTSD. I used to be diagnosed with bipolar disorder. So I take a lot of medications, a shitload of medications. And so I like to read the medical journals to see what new medications are coming out, maybe less side effects or something better. I recently read in a journal that Flintstones Vitamins is coming out with a chewable morning after pill for teens and young adults. Because, well, if they could swallow, then they wouldn't need emergency contraception, would they?
No. Sorry.
And that joke got me out of a ticket in Ohio with the Ohio State Police.
Well, maybe the cop looked at you with crazy eyes. No, I'm kidding.
I don't think he expected that to come out of my mouth.
Do you ever switch things up and do some improv?
Once in a while I do. I just came off a gig where I did a haunted cave event, and I worked with another actor. He's great at improv, and we would just go back and forth. I would tell jokes, dead jokes, and other jokes, and we would just go back and forth as our characters, and that was a lot of fun.
Oh, that's good. You're going to really think this is funny. One of the guys that actually hosts his shows, he actually was, he used to always say to me, Jane, when you do your comedy, you actually say it like you're saying it like it's a movie script. And I'm not trying to brag, but a lot of people think they could teach people comedy. You can't. It's natural.
No, you can't.
It's easy. It's easy to be funny for certain people if they had bad past or if they're just naturally funny. But some people are like, if I got into Flappers before, he doesn't have to teach me comedy. He thought he would teach me comedy and this and that, everything. I was put under pressure to go to his class. I went to his class, and he doesn't have more experience than me in comedy, I'll tell you this. I don't want to mention his names, but I like Flappers, and if I had a chance to do it again, I probably would go back again, because over there I got a lot of laughs. Yeah, so.
Yeah.
And of course, everything was dirty. I was like, I have a dirty mind. That's why I try to stay clean cut, but I can't. I have a dirty mind.
Yeah, I do too. Like, even watching children's shows with my son, I'm like, that's so dirty what they just said.
I know. Everything is changing now with the comedy and stuff. Do you think you'll ever bomb?
I don't know. I'm scared. Definitely scared. I haven't yet, but
what was your best night doing comedy?
My best night doing comedy? Mm-hmm. I would say the first show I produced here in my small town where I live in upstate New York. I did only 10 minutes. I hired a bunch of comedians from the Albany area that I didn't know. I just went blindly and did that. It was a benefit show for the local domestic violence shelter. And my parents were there. And my dad was never supportive of me doing comedy. And my mother not really either. And they laughed hard at every single thing I said. And it just made me feel like fantastic, on top of the world. Like, I've been looking for their approval for 39 years. And I finally got it. It was nice.
Yeah, you know what? One thing that's hard to do is invite family. So, did you ever work with puppets?
No, I have not. But I hear you do.
Well, he's lonely. He wants. He's looking. Hi, I'm Mr. Nosy Wise Ass, and I have a wise ass. Actually, you know what happened? I ordered this for a girl that picked out someone that she would make out with. And I was like, oh my God, she wanted, I was like, I found someone else to for another role for the Sophie character. It's like, I ordered a big one. And I was like, oh no, she claimed she couldn't hold the other one. So I started to order big puppets. And I was thinking, maybe she needs an old guy puppet so she could complain to him. I actually want, there's another girl puppet we have. And I kind of want to add a fake chest to her so that way he won't, think he should go for Chrissy. Yeah, Chrissy's my girlfriend now. She started dating me. You know what happened? I have some puppets. My friend made a really a good one, the big chest. I'll show you. I'll send you some of my movies. They actually have. All I could think of is a few of my puppets are missing because every time I give away puppets, I never get them back. So now we're thinking of making a movie where we're chasing the person down that stole it, and we'll go driving. We'll be searching for the puppets. So go ahead. Say something comedic.
Okay, I will. My cat Madison unfortunately passed away last summer. I spent over $1,000 to try to save her. You know, you'll do anything for your pets. You love them. Sometimes they're your family. They feel like your family. Sometimes they're even better than your family. But the whole point to this whole story is, guys, I guess I know how it feels now to spend all your money on pussy and get nothing in return.
Oh, wow. Well, that's perfect for downtown Detroit. do you have any clean-cut jokes?
Nothing I can think of on the top of my head. No, I have written clean stuff. I have done clean shows, and I just like I like them, but it just doesn't feel like me because I'm so filthy. Like, all right, let me think. What can I pull from? Oh, I actually do have a clean one. I do have a clean one I could think of. I'm on so many psych medications that CVS has become like my Cheers, where everybody knows my name and what psych meds I'm on.
Oh, I like that. do you take anything handwritten when you do your comedy, or you just do it without anything handwritten?
I don't do with it. I used to, my light is like flipping for some reason. I used to bring notes and then I would just like look at them before the show and then it would just screw everything up in my head. Like I would forget what the hell I was talking about. So now I just go no notes. But then I get nervous because I'm sitting there watching all the other comedians and they have all their notes and it's like, maybe I should have brought them. I don't know. But I do way better without having the notes there.
Oh, wow. That's good. You know why? It sort of reminds me of me when I go grocery shopping. I have when I write things down, I have it kind of memorized, but I still pull out the sheet. Where's everything? I think I know where everything is. Of course I do. Without your notes.
My number one fear is forgetting jokes on stage. And it happens to every comedian. And it has happened to me before. And I just kind of pause for a brief second and then just kind of make a joke about like.
Well, I just like to thank you for your time, and thank you for being a part of One-on-One with Jane, and I think we said enough, so there's probably going to be 3 to 5 different scenes we can use out of this.
Thank you for having me. I enjoyed myself.